Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here. Still in Las Vegas for a few more days. Gonna be doing a home church on Sunday. Been able to meet with some people this week, get some things done, and then tomorrow, it was supposed to have been today, but it's been kind of flooded around here. And where I'm at, I can't really get out with all the rain. So tomorrow, it looks like we're going to be doing an exorcism. So please pray for that. I ask for your prayers for the, as the Lord has authority, and the Lord has given me authority, and all of us, in the name of Christ, the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we have authority over all the power of the enemy. That's not what I intended on doing this video about, but I just wanted to, let me just say this as I just hit on that point. All Christians have authority. I've made videos about this before. You know, there's two extremes. There's those people who honor preachers to the point of they become Nicolaitans, which is means victory over the laity. An extreme example, as I mentioned many times, is Roman Catholicism, where it becomes a priestly class versus the regular people, trying to copy what was done in the Old Testament. With the priest, and you know, the people couldn't go directly to the Lord except through the priest. And then the New Testament tells us there's one mediator between God and man, that's our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. But on the other hand, on the other extreme, which is most of the people on YouTube who are vocally, actively trolling and making comments, they do not respect, as the Bible says, as Paul talks about to Timothy, a person who is a preacher is a man of God. That's a biblical expression that the Apostle Paul used, man of God. So God does have elders, okay? He has elders, and some elders are preachers. Some elders are, you know, and categorizing that would be really your deacons and all these kind of different things. Some teach and some don't, but you have elders in the church, and they have special authority from God. And the, as I say, you have the extremism of the Nicolaitans and religion that you see in lots of churches, but yet the people who are mostly watching this video are on the other extreme. They have anarchy, and God does have order in His church, but yet it's not man-made structure on the other extreme. So it's just like looking at the greasy gracers, people who believe you can say one prayer when you're 8 years old to get saved and then live like the devil all their life and go to heaven. And then on the other extreme, you have those who are Judaizers who believe you have to follow the law to the letter and obey all of this kind of stuff under the law of Moses, or you're going to hell. And those are the two extremes in that category. So there's many different areas where the Lord has used me to teach about extremism. And this is an example. And here, let me tell you some things. The number one exorcist in the world, and it's not Catholicism, but there's a man named Carlos Anaconda. You can go look him up. And one of his proteges is a man from Italy. I'm trying to think of his name. It's like Barsconi or something like that. But anyway, he had written a book, Handbook to Spiritual Warfare and Deliverance, a deliverance handbook. Very simply written, lays out, because I've done lots of studying. I've read lots of books and stuff on deliverance. This guy's book was very simple, but yet covered all the bases, and you know, just didn't go into detail. They kind of gave an outline of everything. And what this brother gave some examples, you know, and I mentioned this many times, brothers and sisters, demons have authority from God. I know it's hard to, you know, I try to make a new video and not go back and have to repeat myself, but then again, you have people that didn't see the other video, so I have to touch on those things. Demons have God-given authority, as God used Satan to enter Judas in order to betray the Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord used Nebuchadnezzar to betray Israel, even he was a sinner. He even gave King Nebuchadnezzar a dream, dreams from God, but yet he was not a man of God. So you have all these examples, you know, I mentioned about ungodly people and of course demons and all these things that God uses. As they say, as one brother in Seattle said, he really gave it, you know, because he was just finding out about the Bible and was kind of new at studying all these things, and he made the, you know, the observation, after I was telling him this, what I'm telling you now, he made the observation that the enemy's camp is really the controlled opposition, and that's true. God controls ultimately. He uses Satan to create a potential for sin, a potential for evil. It's like Adam and Eve. God knew Satan was going to tempt Adam and Eve. God allowed for that. God did not make us robots. He gave us a free will. He wanted Adam and Eve to choose to obey him. So therefore, he created a situation where they had the opportunity to obey him or not. If there was no opportunity, it's just like a bird in a cage. If I have a bird in a cage, say, oh, this bird loves me so much, he never left the house. I've had this bird in the cage for years, and he loves me so much, he never goes anywhere. He stays right here with me. He really loves me. Well, if you let the bird out of the cage, open the cage door and see what the bird wants to do, then you will know if the bird really wants to stay there or not by his own free will. So, same thing with Adam and Eve in the garden. So, spiritual warfare. Demons have authority. And as an example of what this... he's famous too, but not as Carlos Santacana, but worked with him for many years, and now he does deliverance also. And he's from Italy, and I can't remember his name, but it's called Handbook for Spiritual Deliverance. This brother gave a story of an example where what Carlos Santacana does is he goes to places, and the demons call him out by name. Just like Paul, you know, they said, have you come to cast us out, Carlos? Please don't cast us out, and all this stuff. So that's his calling from God, and he does it to these mass crusades, especially down in South America, where they have, just like the Philippines, they have all these witch doctors and all that stuff. And so this protege of Carlos Santacana was laying out how to do deliverance with someone. And as an example, they have deliverance tents. You know, they take people to different tents, and then the local pastors, working under the supervision of Carlos Anaconda's ministry, like this guy, he would teach the local pastors under the authority of Carlos Anaconda's, ministry from God. He would teach the local pastors how to do deliverance. So maybe when they're gone, you know, their point is to bring that teaching to the body of Christ in that place. Not only did they do deliverances at that moment, but also to train and raise up future deliverance ministries and teach the pastors the way God operates in this area. So anyway, as a great example, one of those pastors that they were teaching, a local pastor, they cast a demon out of a man and it jumped on that local pastor and would not leave. They couldn't do anything with him, so they actually got Carlos Santacana to come. You know, he's the man, the one that God really anointed to be the leader. As like I said, God has different authority and different responsibility he gives to different people in the church, brothers and sisters. It's not we're all the same, because the Bible talks about us, we're all the same in Christ in salvation. But the giftings and calling of God are without repentance. And God says, Jacob have I loved, but Esau have I hated. So callings to different ministries and different anointings and different destinies, everybody has a different destiny and a different calling. So that's a confusion. There's lots of individual anarchy rebels on YouTube who think that they can go running around and become the next Billy Graham because in their own mind they think that everybody can do that. That's not what the Bible teaches at all. So all you rebellious people, the spirit of rebellion is the spirit of Satan and the spirit of witchcraft, and it's the spirit that caused Satan to fall, was his rebellion out of his pride against God. Anyway, brothers and sisters, so this demon was cast out of a man and jumped on a preacher, and they didn't know what to do. They couldn't do nothing with it, so they actually had to call Carlos Anaconda there because this guy was a preacher, and then they couldn't do nothing with him. They didn't know what to do. So when Carlos Anaconda came, he asked the demon, see, what you got to do first, you most of the time we don't need to talk to demons. We cast them out. If they don't come out, then you bind the demon and you command it to speak in Jesus' name and ask it what his name is, what it's doing there, what authority it has to be there. As an example, you go to a witch doctor. You ask the witch doctor to give you a lucky charm, a love potion or whatever. You get involved in that. You play the Ouija board, whatever, for Americans. You play the Ouija board. You gave a demon an opening into your life, possibly by these things. Not always, possibly, highly possible that you got a demonization in your life because you played the Ouija board. So, in this case, Carlos Anaconda asked the demon, what is your authority here? Why are you attacking this man of God? And the demon said, because he is a homosexual. He has secretly been practicing homosexuality. And God demons know who God is and they operate under the authority of God. He said God has tried to lead him in repentance many times, but he has not. Therefore, God has given him over to me, and I have authority over him. See, so this preacher had to be led through repentance, true repentance of homosexuality, and be delivered himself. So just on what I told you, based on that, if you're going to try to do spiritual warfare, you better make sure you sanctify yourself. For all of you greasy gracers, as I just gave the definition for it, you're a greasy gracer, and you think you can walk and live in sin, hide, and do whatever you want to, and then suddenly, oh, you got all this authority in Christ's name. No, the power is in the name of Jesus, not in you. And the Lord operates in his people, those who are walking, those who are led by the Spirit. These are the sons of God. So you're not led by the Spirit when you're living in sin. You're not walking by the Spirit, but you're walking according to the flesh. So sons of God, children of God are the ones who have the authority in Jesus' name. So you better make sure you are sanctified and filled with the Holy Ghost before you go around trying to cast out demons out of people. And God does anoint, like this Carlos Andiconda, he can do it 1,000 times easier than faster than the preachers who are not anointed and called into doing that. God has different anointings and callings. You know, that's something I'm trying to address right now, because the biggest problem I have with trolls on YouTube and dealing with hard-headed knuckleheads on YouTube is people that think that you know, that we're all, everybody, they think that they're a pastor, they think they're a teacher, they think they're an elder, and they think they have some authority in the body of Christ that God did not give them. They're walking in the authority that they have appointed themselves, not from God. Just like, you know, in these and lots of churches you go into, if you wanted to go there as an example, they have a rule, and say, let's just say, I don't want to name, they're all, lots of them are like this, say the Methodist or Presbyterian, whatever. They have these rules that you have to go get a master's degree in theology, and they're approved seminary. You go through some confirmation classes or whatever. They have this man-made process. And then they say, you know, like the Pope, you know, dominus, omnus, whatever, dumbus, retardationus. Then, hey, now you're a preacher with them. You're ordained by them. No, nothing to do with God's calling. This is all true. And that's where you get all this powerless, weak, false doctrines and all that, because these people are tares. These people aren't even saved, and if they are saved, they're not called. I know many, say I know of some, I'll say many, I know some people who are pastors in these denominations who are only staying there because it's their salary. They've discovered they don't even believe in the Lord, but they're staying in the job as a pastor of denominational churches because that's their income. And when they were a teenager, they kind of believed, never really maybe even saved, and now they're doing it as just a job. This is the kind of people you deal with. So being an ordained minister in a church does not make you called by God to be a pastor. And then on the other hand, just because you say you're called doesn't mean you're called. Jesus said, talking about prophets, false prophets and servants of God, not just all people. Jesus in there, when he said you will know them by the fruit they bear, he was specifically talking about people who are preachers. He said you'll know them by the fruit they bear. You're talking about false prophets and obviously real prophets and preachers of the Word of God. You will know them by the fruit they bear. Brothers and sisters, and the Lord has got me on this. I'm getting ready to pray for the list of names. I have the fourth list of names. I used it on a little piece of paper here instead of the big paper. I'm getting ready to make a video about that. The Lord is just leading me to talk about this spiritual authority in the church. Spiritual authority in the church is the topic of this video. There are people who think that they have they're self-appointed. There's tons of them, and that's the negative side of YouTube, is anybody can go on there and make a video and say whatever they want. And then the positive side of YouTube is anybody can go make a video and say what they want. You know what I mean? That's the two-edged sword of YouTube. The part that shocks me, though, is how many people will follow somebody on YouTube, even when they come out saying they're one of the two witnesses. You know, you don't usually attack people on YouTube. I made a video saying that the two witnesses are not on YouTube, and some of their worshipers, their idolater, people making idols out of them, you know, trolled on me and attacked me and, you know, and all this, because I'm saying that some woman, number one, is a female, because it says there'll be men, from America who's not an Israeli, who's a Gentile, is not one of the two witnesses and not one of the 144,000 witnesses. You know, talking about the 144,000 witnesses. Just basic biblical teaching here. But these people have self-appointed authority, not from God. Brothers and sisters, I was hoping that when, like even the biggest name on YouTube, the sensational exaggeration, lie, you know, it's untrue news articles to sensationalize to get viewers. Elion, Comet Elion, Comet ISO, flares from the sun, all of this stuff is nothing to do with the Word of God, nothing to do with the gospel. It's just all hype and sensationalism and date setting. And I've just been in my spirit and in my mind hoping that there will be a day, it will be like the boy who cried wolf, that these people who keep giving a sounding a false alarm, watchmen, self-appointed watchmen sounding false alarms, that people would one day have enough enlightenment in their mind to see that they are being stirred up with a spirit of fear and entangled in all of this hype that is not from the Spirit of the Lord. The Spirit of the Lord is where the Spirit of the Lord, there's liberty. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but a power and of love and a sound mind. Now I'm going to give you a word from the Lord, and I'm going to give a word by the grace of God for these people as the Lord would give me the utterance. Here's a word from the Lord. The Lord's going to send revival before the rapture. I've been saying that for a couple of years, but the Lord just spoke to me again today, about two or three times today, of a revival. God is going to send revival to this world before the rapture. We will see a revival. Now, is the revival going to be for 1 week, 1 month, 1 year, 5 years? I have no idea. No man, Jesus said, no man knows the day or the hour. He's coming as a thief in the night. No, there won't be 3 days of darkness before the rapture. That is a false Catholic seer who said that about 150 years ago, not even a Christian. If there was 3 days of darkness before the rapture, then the Lord would not be coming as a thief in the night, because we would all know that that he was going to come at a certain time. Once the darkness started, well, we could count 3 days. He's going to be here. The darkness is before the second coming. The earth will be dark, and the sign of the Son of Man, as Jesus said, would appear in the sky before the second coming. But he didn't say it would be 3 days. He didn't say if it'd be 5 minutes or it could be 5 days. We don't know. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I don't know why, you know, the Lord is leading me to make this video about spiritual authority in the church, spiritual warfare, authority over the kingdom of Satan. We have what keeps the enemy from attacking us. The Lord is just speaking this to me as I'm making this video. What protects you from the enemy? What protects you from the enemy? A hedge from the Lord. How do you have a hedge from the Lord? Now, it talks about there in, as you read in Job, and then also when you read in Malachi chapter 3, is that the Lord said when people give, under the law is tithing, giving, that God would, you know, rebuke the devourer for you. But this is what the Lord is telling me to tell you. In addition to that, the enemy has authority in your life and my life from sin. We're in a fallen world from our sin. As I gave you the example, the guy was a homosexual, secretly refused to repent. God gave him many chances to repent. He wouldn't repent, so the Lord publicly humiliated him and also allowed him to be demon-possessed in front of everybody. Everybody knows about it. Because he refused to repent, and did not repent how many times? So the more you walk in holiness, the more the hedge of the Lord is around you. Job being the exception to that. But the Lord, in the end, delivered Job and gave him double portion of everything that he had and extended his life. Because that was an example of God was showing that Job would bless him and not curse him as Satan had said he would do. So brothers and sisters, the lesson for you is A, never curse the Lord. Always bless the Lord. And the Lord will honor you for that. And number two, the word from the Lord for you is to get the enemy out of your life is to walk in holiness. Those who are led by the Spirit, these are the sons of God. Even as it says in the 23rd Psalm, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Why? Because you are with me. Thou art with me. How can two walk together except they be in agreement? Amos 3:3. So if you're not walking with the Lord, not your own way, and that's the problem with 90% of the people I deal with on YouTube, they're walking in their own will and their own way, not in the Lord's will and the Lord's way. The Lord is the one, you know, Lord, Jesus, this is what people are doing. They pray their will to be done, and they expect the Lord to come in agreement with them instead of they become in agreement with the kingdom of God. Now, if you want to walk in agreement with the Lord Jesus Christ, it's not a mutual agreement. Jesus is the way, not a way, or not, as one famous preacher says, God is not sitting in heaven saying, let's make a deal. He's saying, this is the deal. God only has one path for us to follow. That's the Lord Jesus Christ. And then each one of us individually, the Lord has a path for us to follow in our lives. He has a destiny. He has predestined us, the Bible says, whom he foreknew, he did predestine to be conformed to the image of his Son, Jesus Christ. So the Lord has a path for you individually to follow. We all don't have the exact same path. As an example, me, the Lord called me to be a preacher and go to the Philippines and all of those things. You have a different path. Even though we have common things to do, we all each have our individual path. As you get in that path and walk with the Lord and walk in his will and walk it out, the closer you are to the Lord, the enemy cannot come and touch the anointing. The Lord has just given me a Bible verse. More Bible verses to back that up. Because the problem with lots of these false teachers and all this hoopla on YouTube, they're not giving any Bible verses. And by the grace of God, I think that's what's unique about my YouTube channel. And the Lord just gave me a confirmation to back up the word that he just gave me. And this is it. Psalm 91 verse 1 and verse 2. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my shield and my strength, my God in whom I will trust. And then on in Psalm 91, it says, though 1,000 may fall at my right hand, at my left hand, and 10,000 at my side, my right hand and 10,000 at my side, it shall not come nigh me. It shall not come near me. Why? What does it say in that text? Why will it not come near you? And then God says, because he has set his love upon me, and I will honor him and show him, you know, I will give him long life and show him my salvation. So those who set their love upon the Lord, those who dwell in the secret place of the Most High God, abide under his shadow. And then all of this pestilence and noisome pestilence and the snare of the fowler, it's a King James word, the snare that the devil has for you, it will not get you because you're dwelling in the secret place of the Most High. You know, just like all these words, even though we have different callings and God uses me as a real, there's all these people claiming to be prophets, God really uses me. My ministry is a prophetic ministry, and I'll tell you why. Besides the fact that God called me to it, it's because I try to dwell in the secret place of the Most High, even though no one's perfect. By no means am I perfect. But dwelling in the secret place of the Most High, that means seeking, asking, and knocking. That means getting in the holy place. Is, you know, if you sin so much, you get stuck out there in the outer court at the brazen altar of repentance, the altar of sacrifice. You can't never get into the holy place and where the Word of God is and the light of the Holy Spirit. And you definitely can't get into the Holy of Holies where the secret place of the Most High God is, where you can hear the voice of God. You got to stop clowning around out there in the outer court, and you got to get past the altar of repentance, which is the brazen altar where they offer sacrifices. You got to get past the inner court. And, you know, spend your time there reading the Word, which is the bread of life, the bread, the show bread, the Word of God, you know, that part of Jesus Christ, the Word, and getting filled with the Holy Spirit, which is, you know, the candelabra, the menorah there, the light, the oil of the Holy Spirit lit up there, and press in past the altar, the incense altar of prayer and intercessory prayer, and get into the holy place where the ark is, where the mercy seat is, where the Lord himself dwelleth. And that's where you can hear the voice of the Lord yourself and get a word from the Lord yourself and overhear what's being said in the throne room of God. Stop clowning around with all of this wild speculation and debating of doctrines and theology and all this horse manure on YouTube, and get a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, most of you are seeking a personal relationship. But those big mouth trolls are the very ones who, with all of this debates that they copied and pasted, it's not even their own idea. It's just something that they heard on YouTube and are running wild with it, copying and pasting it all over the place, like little children, Even as Jesus said, how do I compare this generation? They're like little children standing in the marketplace, you know, saying you played, a funeral song for us. Yeah, and you played a joyful song for us. I mean, you know, that's a whole nother teaching. I'll get into that next time as the Lord leads me. The point is you're running to and fro and you're not satisfied. Even as Jesus was talking about, John the Baptist came, neither eating nor drinking, and you said, he's a false prophet. Then Jesus came eating and drinking, and you said, he's a drunk. So these people, this generation is like that generation. And the judgment that befell that generation in 70 AD, when the temple in Jerusalem was destroyed, and the Spirit of the Lord departed, as it did before in generations past, and it departed again, and that day, the Spirit of the Lord is about to depart out of this world and take those few members of the bride with him. And that is the word of the Lord, that God is going to send a revival of holiness and repentance. And those people who will be caught up in it will be caught up in it to meet the Lord in the air. And those who are left here are going to be left behind. And the Lord is just showing me. While I'm looking at this, I'm seeing it in my spirit while I'm making this video. Another thing that the Lord has shown me, it's about the shepherd's rod. The Lord had given me this a long time ago, but every year in Israel, the shepherd would hold up his arm and then the sheep would pass underneath and the shepherd would inspect all the sheep. And I got to go look that up because I don't know the Bible verses off the top of my head, but it's in the Old Testament. The sheep that passed under there that were without spot or blemish went through, and then the other ones were, separated. That's your sheep and your goat separation. But that's what the Lord has shown me right now while I'm making this video. The Lord is about to separate his spotless sheep from his spotted sheep. Those who are not right with him is a way you could say it in a natural way. Those of you who are living in sin and not living and walking in the righteousness and the humility. It's not about being perfect. Those greasy gracers, they always say that. It's not about being perfect, brothers and sisters. It's ultimately, it's about humility. For God said in his word, God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. And that's really just so simple. No one is perfect. Even the Apostle Paul said that he was the chief among sinners. That's the attitude, humility that God is looking for, that just... as I'm going to keep going, the Lord, when he told the parable of the publican or tax collector who went into the temple at the same time as one of these rabbis did, and this Pharisee said, looked up to heaven and said, thank you, God, I'm not like this tax collector. Like him, I fast twice a week, I do my tithing, I do all these great things, and thank you, God, I'm not like this tax collector. And then Jesus said the tax collector wouldn't even look up. He hit himself in the chest and said, forgive me, Lord, I'm a sinner. And Jesus said that man, the tax collector, went down from the Temple Mount justified, and the other man did not. That's exactly what I'm talking about. That spirit of self-righteousness, of Phariseeism, of all of this legalism and all of these arrogant, self-appointed, not by God teachers, in the churches and on YouTube, because we're talking YouTube now, but of course in all of these churches I've been talking about. Self-appointed or appointed by man, that's not of God. They are not justified in the eyes of the Lord. To be right, they're not right standing with God. But those who are humble, God gives grace to the humble. Those who admit, Lord, I'm a sinner. Lord, just like the thief on the cross said, he called him Lord. And that's, just like Paul, when Paul was blinded on the road to Damascus, he said, what do you want me to do, Lord? Who are you, Lord? He called him Lord. The man on the cross, the thief on the cross said, remember me, Lord, when you come into your kingdom. That's all he said, and he was saved. Remember me, Lord. Lord, he called him Lord, when you come into your kingdom. That's what he said. That's being humble. That's being humble. He even said, hey, we've been criminals. We deserve to be crucified, but this man didn't do anything wrong, and they're crucifying him. That is the attitude that we need to have. This guy was a thief, was getting ready to die, but yet he acknowledged Jesus Christ as Lord and said, he just said, remember me. That is what God is looking for. And I'm telling you, there's tons of you who are not prepared to meet the Lord. You are not ready. You are not ready because you're walking in pride and arrogance and self-righteousness. Get off of your high horse and be of low estate. As Jesus said, when you go to a wedding banquet, don't go sit at the head table, because you're going to look like a moron when someone asks you to move down to the lowest end of the table. That's why Jesus said, when you go to a feast, you sit at the lowest end of the table, and then they may bid you to move up higher to a more honored seat. Now, that you think Jesus was just talking about going to a wedding? No, he was talking about you seeking him and your place in the kingdom of God. You know, everybody I know who's really called by God, that's really a preacher, if you listen to them, they'll say, well, you know, I don't want to preach, but God is compelling me to. You know, my natural flesh, I don't want to get up in front of people and speak, but God is compelling me to. And then those who love attention, those who are showmen and clowns and love to get attention and be right in the center stage, and it's all about them, and they're getting attention and get people to follow them, that's the very ones who are the Pied Pipers. You know who the Pied Piper was? He promised to get rid of all the rats there, but instead he let all the children out of the village in that children's fable. But really, the Pied Piper is Satan. Satan is the Pied Piper who is leading people and stealing the children of God, those who would be the children of God, stealing them away with his sweet-sounding music, from Joel Osteen's words to rock music, rap music, you know, all this country music about cheating and getting drunk and going to jail and shooting your dog and all of that stuff, to the sweet sound of tickling ear preaching. As I mentioned, Joel Osteen is the most famous example, to false religions, to Mormonism, Islam, whatever it may be, that's a Pied Piper music that's calling away and stealing children who could become children of God, but instead they choose to be children of the devil. But brothers and sisters, I'm talking to people on YouTube, and it's such a shame, you know, to be so close, but yet miss the mark of salvation. It's a shame to be so close and then rely on your own self-righteousness, your own self-appointedness. The only thing you need to do, the number one thing, all the talking about the sinner's prayer and all that, the thing you have to do is humble yourself. Humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, and he will give you strength. Humble yourself and say, Lord, I don't know what to do. I mean, all I know is I'm a sinner and I'm in need of your grace, your mercy, your forgiveness. I know that Jesus died for me. I know that he rose again on the third day. And I know that because he lives, I will live also. And I know that Jesus is the only one who can save me, not myself or my good deeds, but only you have called us to follow you, Lord Jesus. The Lord Jesus called us. He said, follow me. He who does not take up his cross daily and follow me is not worthy of me, Jesus said. He who puts his hand to the plow and then looks back is not worthy of me. Follow Jesus every day and humble yourself every day and say, Lord, I'm a sinner. Forgive me, save me, deliver me, lead me, guide me. You want to hear from God? Get past all of this elementary stuff, as it says in Hebrews chapter 6. You got to get past arguing and debating about a cup of milk before and the bread before you can ever get to the meat. You want to get into the secret place of the Most High? The fastest way to bypass all the noise and all the hassle is to shut your mouth and lower yourself. Humble yourself. Lower yourself. Lower yourself. And you can go into the secret place of the Most High God by the blood of Jesus, by the power of his Holy Spirit, through humility. Your part is faith and humility to get into there. And you can hear from God yourself. Wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord, I say, as the Bible says. Wait upon the Lord, I say. He will speak to you in due season if you have an ear to hear. Ask God in humility. Don't say, oh, well, we're all Christians. We're all the same. Are we? Well, why did God give some this gift and some that gift and divide it severally among us as he wills? Why did he give some apostles and some pastors, some prophets, some teachers and some evangelists if we're all the same? No, we're all the same in salvation. Number one, you need to get off your high horse, learn to divide the word, and learn to separate out the difference between salvation and giftings and callings. You need to get off of your high horse and humble yourself and let the Lord lead you by His Spirit and His Word. God bless you guys. I'm going to come back by the grace of God with words for these brothers and sisters who asked me. And I don't mind doing it because the Lord told me to do it. And, you know, this is for the Lord. This is for your blessing, but it's for the Lord. There's lost people that can see this. And I asked you, like the people that's already been doing, comment and say, you know, hey, just like lots of people did, hey, that was really from the Lord. And, you know, let some non-believers see that. Let some trolls see that who don't believe in the gifts of the Spirit. And let them see that maybe they'll humble themselves when they, when, you know, when they can't gainsay against what God's doing. God bless you guys.